Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amma ba'd. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you and to introduce you to a brand new show and a brand new podcast called The Hot Seat. To understand a little bit more about The Hot Seat, we first have to understand the context of the modern day world we find ourselves living in the year 2019. It is a world in which perhaps there are more doubts, misconceptions, and misinterpretations that are thrown around about the religion of Islam than in any other period of time in the history of mankind. The internet is a number one source used by people globally to acquire information on any topic, and it is riddled and full of false notions and erroneous ideologies about the deen of Allah, Azza wa Jal. Our kids, ourselves, are being exposed to this kind of information on a daily, and if not daily, then at the very least weekly basis. And whether we know it or not, whether we choose to accept it or not, it is having an effect on ourselves, our hearts, our minds, and ultimately our understanding of this beautiful religion. To further complicate the problem, many of us find ourselves living in Western societies where the governments and the social norms and pressures are constantly trying to redefine what is good and what is bad, what is accepted and what is rejected, what Islam is and is allowed to be, and what Islam is never allowed to be. All of this, my brothers and sisters, ultimately leads to confusion, it leads to ignorance, and if Allah permits, it can lead to misguidance. The Hot Seat has therefore been designed with the permission of Allah alone to counter these kind of modern day, contemporary issues head on by using the knowledge and the guidance of the Muslims of the past, the early generations of Muslims, the best of generations. There's not a single Muslim on the face of the planet today that would doubt the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completed our religion for us over 1400 years ago. And that completed, holistic, perfect religion is just as applicable now in the year 2019 as it was back then. We truly do have classical solutions for contemporary problems. However, this isn't your normal average Islamic lecture series. First of all, it's not a lecture, it's a discussion between two parties, often opposing parties, in an attempt to reach the truth, bi-idhnillah. And secondly, and perhaps more importantly, it's a unique, one-of-its-kind interactive podcast where you, from the comfort of your own home, have the opportunity to vote for and to choose the topic we'll be discussing on the show. You also have the chance to ask your own questions on these contemporary issues and to grill the speaker if you feel like he hasn't been grilled enough on the show itself. I'll be releasing details of how you can do both of those things at the end of this episode. But for now, without any further ado, let's get into this episode of The Hot Seat.
أولئك الذين كفروا بربهم وأولئك الأغلال في أعناقهم وأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Once again, I'm joined on the Hot Seat podcast with Ustadh Abdul Rahman Hassan, حفظه الله وتعالى. Ustadh, how are you doing today?
Alhamdulillah, Jazakallah khairan.
Jazakallah khairan for joining me. We have a really interesting topic for discussion today, and it's the old debate between reason and revelation. Reason broadly meaning logic, and revelation obviously being the text, the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Are they actually in contradiction with one another? What happens if they appear to be in contradiction with one another? Which one do we prefer? All of these things we, inshallah, will be discussing over the next hour or so. I'd like to start, as we normally do on the Hot Seat, with a definition. What is the definition of aql in the Arabic language?
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, lahu alhamdul hasan, wa thanau al-jameel, wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, yaqulu al-haqqa wa huwa yahdi al-sabeel, wa ashadu anna sayyidina wa nabiyyana Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi, wa attabi'ina lahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. The term aqala, which is a root word of the word aql, it goes back to the meaning of mana. It's to prevent something, or it's to stop something. The scholars, they say that's why it's called iqalul ba'ir, the riding beast, the rope that is that's tied on the camel or the horse is called iqal. It comes from the word, or the same word, it's the same word as aql, which is to prevent the riding beast from running away. And the scholars, they say the reason why aql is called aql is because yamna'u sahibuhu mimma la yaliq. It prevents the person from that which is not befitting. And that's what the author of the kitab Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha said. He said it means al-habisu an dhamim al-qawl wal-fi'l. Aql is the thing that prevents a person from unwise statement or a inappropriate statement or action. That's what aql is there for. Like in the teacher of Sibawayhi, Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi, in the Kitab al-Ayn, some scholars, they question whether the book can be attributed to him. But the point is that Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi, he said that aql is naqidhul jahli. It's the opposite of ignorance. And while we're at this point, it's important to mention that the aql, when it comes to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, it's actually divided into four. The first one is al-ghariza. The first one is al-ghariza التي جعلها الله في الإنسان. It's the innate ability that Allah has placed inside the human. It's, in other words, it's what people will consider you to be sane. And if you don't have it, they'll consider you to be insane. Or it's what distinguishes us from all other species and gives us that unique, distinct characteristics and attribute. The second thing that aql is meant in the Sharia, the Kitab, the Sunnah, is al-ulum al-daruriyah, the essential knowledge. The knowledge which everybody really shares. Like everyone here knows that one is more than half. Essential knowledge. And number three, which is al-ulum al-nadariyah, theoretical knowledge. Also is referred to as aql, theoretical knowledge. But theoretical knowledge means the knowledge that's specific to a person who has the ability to observe, the ability to research, the ability to critically analyze something. That's the third type. And the fourth one is al-amalu bil-ilm. Implementing knowledge is also called aql. When a person implements the knowledge that they know, it's also called, or it's also referred to as aql, as Allah said in the ayah, وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ فَاعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ فَسُحْقًا لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. That they said if we had aql, meaning if we implemented the knowledge that we had, the information that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought to us, if we took it on board and we implemented it, we would not be from the inhabitants of the hellfire. There's one point I want to say, which is whenever you hear the concept of reason versus revelation, from those four, is only referring to the theoretical knowledge.
Okay.
That's the only type of logic or aql, intellect, that can kind of go against revelation. Or if it can, whether it can or can't, we'll speak about it more into the, but it's that type. It's the third type, which is the theoretical knowledge, not the other three. No.
Okay, that's the main type that we're obviously going to focus on in today's podcast, bi'idhnillah. Do you want to unpackage that one a little bit more? Just tell us a little bit more about exactly what this type means.
So when it comes to, they say thinking, or they say reasoning, they divide it into three types. The different type of reasoning is three. The first one is deduction, and the second type is induction, and the third type is abduction. The deduction is a conclusion which is reached based on evidences that were gathered. So it's based on observational evidence. Something you observed, you reached a conclusion based on it. Sometimes it can be flawed. Sometimes it can be a fallacy. It can be an illogical absurdity. I'll give you an example. A person says an apple, all apples are fruits. And then they say, this is a fruit, which is two premise. And the third, the inference or the conclusion that they reach is that therefore it is an apple. You can see how flawed that is.
Right. Yeah.
Even though it might sound plausible in the first premise, or it sounds or seems sound in its first two premise, but the conclusion is wrong. That's called deduction. The induction is that a person observes many data. They look at many things, and from there they reach a final conclusion. It's called induction. And that's all based upon how much you've seen and how much you've observed. And inshallah ta'ala, later when I talk about the issue of is intellect and reasoning restricted or is it unrestricted, we'll talk about it there inshallah ta'ala. The final one is abduction. And abduction usually starts with observing something and looking at something which the data and the information that you have regarding is very limited. You don't have much. And then you reach a general statement regarding it. Or you try to best explain it.
Mm-hmm.
That's roughly what they all three mean.
I'd like to throw in a fourth one there, especially when we're talking about the role that this type of intellect has when it comes to the religion. And this is something that I see that is quite common, and it's the issue of confirmation bias, where essentially a person is brainwashed into a religion from birth. They're told that this religion is true. And later on in life, they may start to use their reason, their intellect. They may come across scientific knowledge and they interpret all of that information and they interpret their reason and their intellect in line with what they were previously taught from birth, that this religion is true. So either they'll reinterpret the text itself or they'll reinterpret the scientific information that they come across later on in life to make sure that it matches the text. And this is what I see many religious people doing. Would you agree with this?
You see, there's a book I read recently. It's written by John Lennox. It's called Did Science Bury God? I think that was the name of the book. Can Science Explain Everything? I think it was one of those names. The point is that John Lennox mentioned something I think was very good and I really benefited from it, which is he said that explanation are two types.
Mm-hmm.
Explanation are two types. If someone came into the kitchen and saw you boiling water and they asked you, what is this? There's two explanations you can give. There may be many more. There's at least two explanations you can give. You can give a scientific explanation by telling them that there's heat that is boiling the water from beneath, then that which is agitating the molecules, and you can give a scientific explanation. And you can also say, oh, I just want tea. One explanation doesn't eliminate the other. And this is the problem that I, inshallah ta'ala, want to tackle more, which is that thinking and assuming that when science comes, it shuts everything else. And it's the only explanation. And there's nothing else that can explain anything. Itself is an unscientific statement. So I think we'll talk about that more, inshallah ta'ala.
Okay, you've unpackaged the issue of the logic and what the definition of the intellect is quite nicely. And obviously we're well aware of what revelation is. It's the Qur'an and the Sunnah. In the Islamic religion, does the aql, does the intellect have any role? What kind of level does it have in the religion?
The aql in our religion has a manzila rafi'ah, has a high position. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, manatu taklif. For you to be burdened to come with salah, to pray to Allah Azza wa Jalla, to pay your zakat, to go to pilgrimage, hajj, all of that, the condition for it is that you have aql. The aql I'm referring to here is you have sanity. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He didn't force or didn't burden a person to pray when they have no aql. You know the famous hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ. The pen is lifted from three. عَنِ النَّائِمِ حَتَّى يَسْتَيْقِظ. The one who is sleeping until he wakes up. وَعَنِ الصَّبِي حَتَّى يَحْتَلِم. And the young child until he reaches age of puberty. The kid, until the child reaches age of puberty, he doesn't have to pray. وَعَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَعْقِلَ. And the insane one until he regains sanity again. So number one, the evidence to show how Islam honors al-aql, you can see that it won't, if you don't have aql, it doesn't burden you with anything. Number two is the Quran and the Sunnah, if you look at it, it pushed us. And now حَثَّ عَلَىٰ إِعْمَالِهِ, it urged us, it encouraged us to use our intellects. Any ayah you come across in the Qur'an where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقَفَالُهَا أَفَلَمْ يَتَدَّبَّرُوا الْقَوْلَ. Where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala also said, those who, you know, الَّذِينَ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, they say, رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِينَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. You know, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِينَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. They look at the sky, they look at the earth, they ponder over everything. I mean, Allah is telling us to use our aql here. I mean, I was telling one brother one time, what Charles Darwin did when he traveled and gathered data, information. It was something our religion urged us to do way before. Of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, why did they not travel the earth? And what are they going to do when they travel the earth? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, they look at كَيْفَ بَدَأَ الْخَلْقُ, how the creation started. So, using our logic and using our minds is something the Qur'an and the Sunnah urged us to do. The third is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he praised the people of أَنَّهُ أَثْنَى عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ الْعُقُولِ الرَّاجِحَةِ. Allah praised the people who have a smart, who are clever, who use them in intellects and who reason. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala praised them. The ayah Allah says وَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, the only ones who take the reminder in are those who have intellect. Those who are mature minded. Also, number four, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he rebuked a people who chose to forsake using their intellect. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمُ اتَّبِعُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ قَالُوا بَلْ نَتَّبِعُ مَا أَلْفَيْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا أَوَلَوْ كَانَ آبَاؤُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says that when they're told, follow that which your Lord has sent down onto you, قَالُوا, they said, نَتَّبِعُ مَا أَلْفَيْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا, we will follow that which was brought to us from our forefathers. Allah says, أَوَلَوْ كَانَ آبَاؤُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا هُمْ يَهْتَدُونَ, even if their fathers, they didn't have aql and they were not guided, will you still do that? So these people didn't want to use their logic. They just wanted to follow their forefathers. They just wanted to blind follow their previous ancestors. So you can see from those points that the aql has a high station in our religion now. Okay. Last but not least, the fifth evidence, or the fifth point is, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he made the aql from the daruriyat al-khams, the five things that need to be protected. If a person, Ibn Qudama rahimahullah, mentions in his kitab al-Mughni, and he brought a consensus, an ittifaq, an ijma', that if a person damages a person's brain, it's like he killed him, he has to pay a full diya. He has to pay a full diya. Full diya means a full blood money, like you killed this person, because you took away from him what? An essential component of the human. So to say that Islam does not honor the intellect and it doesn't honor thinking and reason, it's a mistaken belief and a false argument.
So what I'm getting from that then is that the intellect, the aql, is kind of like an overriding dominant feature in the religion and it should be prioritized above anything else. Is that what you're saying now?
When it comes to reasoning, when it comes to thinking, when it comes to the mind, Ahlul Sunnah are in the middle path. وَسَطٌ فِي شَأْنِ الْعَقْلِ بَيْنَ الْغُلَاتِ وَالْجُفَاتِ. Ahlul Sunnah, they lie in the middle between those who are extreme in exaggeration and those who are extreme in negligence. And you tend to find that any issue, there's always two extremes which are diametrically opposing to one another. They're divergently on different tracts. The first group are extreme in exaggeration and there's another group which is extreme in negligence. Ahlul Sunnah are in the middle. Who are the people who are extreme in exaggeration and who are the people who are extreme in negligence? Ahlul Kalam. And Ahlul Kalam are the Mu'tazila the within Islam we're talking about, the Mu'tazila, who originated from Wasim ibn Ata and Amr ibn Ubayd, the Asha'ira, and we'll talk more about that, Fakhruddin al-Razi, and Fakhruddin al-Razi is considered to be the man who put the most arguments for Ash'ariyah. But he wasn't the man who placed the first bricks. The first bricks was placed by Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. You see them, Asha'ira, the Maturidiyah, and the likes of these. They are referred to as Ahlul Kalam. They went overboard when it came to the Aqal. They exceeded their limits. They came with extreme exaggeration.
In what way? So they would say what? That the Aql is above everything else?
They placed and they gave the Aql and they gave allowance to the Aql and a lead way to the Aql in places that it's not its field of expertise. It's not a place that it should talk in. This is not its place.
Even though we've agreed that it has such a high role in the religion.
Which I want to expand on later, inshallah ta'ala. But the Aql, according to the Asha'ira and the Mu'tazila and the Maturidiyah, they done ghulu. They went overboard with it. We know the Aql, it can't... the Aql can bring you to... the Aql can bring you to the belief of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And that Allah exists, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it can bring you into the general... guidance, the comprehensive guidance, but detailed issues of guidance, the Aql can't do that. It's not his field of expertise. And I'll talk about that later, inshallah ta'ala. The second group who are extreme in negligence are the Sufiya, the Mutasawwifa. The Sufiya, they rebuked the Aql and they rebuked anything related to the Aql, the mindset and the thinking process and psychological observation, all of that, they threw it under the bus. For them, it has no weight whatsoever. That's why you find the mutasawwifa. Their awliya are sometimes considered to be people who are insane. You go to some places in the world and you find that they're worshipping, or that they see a wali, a man who's thrown off his clothes, who's naked, and they'll say, this is a wali min awliya illahi azza wa jalla. The mutasawwifa, if you look at a lot of them drank alcohol, and they were intoxicated, and and that's something that damages the sanity, right? That's something that damages the aql and the way that the person thinks. So the Sufiya, they went to the other extreme of not giving any consideration to the aql. And so when like scientists and modern day Western academics see these type of Sufiya, then they think this is what Islam's like, this is what the religion is like, which is not true now.
So where are Ahlul Sunnah in between them two?
So Ahlul Sunnah believe that the Aql, it has a majal, it has a position, it has a field, it's got a role in the religion, and its role is not unrestricted. لذلك they say العقل وإن كان ذا شأن واعتبار إلا أن حدوده ضيقة ومجالاته محدودة. They believe that the Aql, even though it has a great station in our religion, even though it's considered high, but they say it's not free to do whatever it wants. And they say that the Aql, they give many examples. I just want to give you a basic, understandable example that many can digest. And that is your mobile phone. It works, right?
Yeah.
Does it not mean a lot to you?
Yeah.
Does it not do a good job?
Mm-hmm.
But when you go to another country, your network doesn't necessarily work. Or if you go to a place where there is no network, your phone stops working. So this has a boundary of how it works. The Aql is like your eyesight. Your eyesight, it works. It functions. You can see things, but it's limited what you can see. Can't see everything. There's a distance you can see up to. The Aql is exactly the same. There's a distance in how far it can see. You can't just make your eyesight unrestricted and say, I can see any and everything. You see, walidhalika, they say three things. Ahlul Sunnah say that the Aql is restricted here. He can't talk about it. This is not his field of expertise. The first one is, أَنَّوْ لَا دَخَلَ لَهُ فِي الْغَيْبِيَاتِ. The Aql can't talk about the unseen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because remember what I said to you before. The deduction, and the abduction, which are the three kind of reasoning. All three of them, they all are based on observation, things that you can see. And that's that's what the aql works on. The aql works on what it can see. It works on what it can observe. That's where it then brings a conclusion from. That's where it brings inferences from. But if you don't have the ability to see something, then aql has no room to talk about these issues. Number two is أنه لا يستقل بالهداية. The aql cannot by itself guide. No, it can't. You see, it's not independent in guiding. That's why Ibn al-Qayyim said لا يستقل العقل دون هداية. That the aql is not independent in guiding. بالوحي تأصيلا ولا تفصيلا. It can't, the aql cannot give you detailed guidance. No.
I really want to unpackage this, because this is where most of the discussion takes place. You're basically saying that the aql has limitations.
Oh, without a doubt.
How do you come to know that Islam is a truth and worshipping an idol is false?
You see, when I said it's restricted and it's limited, that doesn't mean it's not functioning. It doesn't function. Of course, agreed, it functions. And I said it to you before, that something that you created, for you to worship what you created, and that depends on you, is an illogical absurdity.
Exactly. So it's actually your logic and your reasoning that you come to know the ultimate truth about the world itself and the reason why we're created to worship Allah alone. If that's the case with the ultimate truth, the most important thing, then how can you say that for things lower than that, the aql won't work?
Okay. The kitab Daru Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql, Shaykh al-Islam Taymi says something very powerful in there. He said, I took you to a doctor. You were ill. You said, I need a doctor who specialize in this. And can you take me to the doctor? Or can someone take me to the doctor? I put my finger up. I said, I can help you. Let me take you to the doctor. So I grabbed you by the hand and I took you to the doctor. Now that I've taken you to the doctor and you've sat and you've spoken to the doctor and you've conversed with the doctor, of course, is going to prescribe a medicine for you. And he's going to tell you what your illness is. How about if I say to you, I was the one who brought you to the doctor? You wouldn't have known the doctor. Mm-hmm. So listen to me now. Don't do what the doctor told you. Do this. Because I am the one who brought you to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be like, that's an illogical absurdity. What are you talking about?
Yeah. I understand what you're saying.
Here's, I want you to understand something. This issue, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he authored a book on it, 10-volume book. And I'll tell you something very important. You see, within Islam, there were smart thinkers. Before I go into this, there was a point I was going to mention. I just don't want to forget it.
Okay.
I said that the aql, even though it has a weight in our religion, there's three things it cannot talk about. The first one was what I said is, أَنَّهُ لَا دَخَلَ فِي الْغَيْبِيَاتِ. The aql cannot talk about the unseen.
Mm-hmm.
The second I said is that, أَنَّهُ لَا يَسْتَقِلُّ بِالْهِدَايَةِ. That the aql cannot independently guide you by itself without no revelation. It can't. And if anybody tries to do that, it will be misguided. You see? The third thing I was going to say was that the aql cannot, أنه لا يستقل بالفصل بين الناس فيما تنازعوا فيه. If two people are disputing one another, you can't necessarily reconcile them with just rational arguments. You cannot. Because every individual's rational mind is not superior to the other. Yours is not higher than mine. There has to be a higher authority that can govern all of us. That's why Allah said in the ayah, فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ.
So you made three important points that I think is worth talking about in a little bit more detail. The first point, I don't think there can be much disagreement on this, that aql can't tell you about knowledge of the unseen, because we can't see that. The second point, the point that you mentioned where the...
But the first point is very important because it's... Sorry to interrupt you, mm-hmm. but it's important because this is where a lot of the modern day militant atheists argue about. They say that, okay, how are you going to reconcile the law of nature and miracles? And it's very important that they understand that the aql has no majal to talk about these issues of miracles. That's just, that is not its boundaries and its level, limits.
Even though we can see stuff, certain things around us, and we can see the laws of the universe operating around us, We know it's completely unrealistic, for example, for a sea to be split open, because we've been living a life and that just doesn't happen in life. Mm. And now you're saying that, for example, Musa alayhi salam split open a sea. This is what you would classify as a miracle, with the permission of Allah, of course.
I mean, there's many...
That doesn't match up to the intellect, I'm sorry.
I know, again, that's my point. That's again, for the aql to understand that, it's not its majal. It's not its field. It shouldn't be talking about it. So, it's the unseen.
So anyone can claim anything. I can say on the way here to Sharjah, I just saw a four-legged man who had a face of the horse. It's unseen to you. And your intellect says, no, this doesn't seem right. But my point is, your intellect has a limit. You have to believe
it. But that's my point. It brings you to the issue of, number one, do you think that the aql, that's what I want you to understand. Do you really think that the aql, like, for example, there's many things that we cannot fathom, but we still believe in them. We can't fathom them.
What's an example?
For example, we believe in gravitational force. No one can actually define for you what gravity is.
We can see the effects of gravity working right now. I can see the effect of that.
But that's exactly God, right?
I can't.
Scientists are saying that we don't, for example, some atheists are saying today, we don't believe in God because we can't observe him. We can't see him. We need to see him. Seeing is believing.
Yes.
So everything has become empirical evidence.
So I'm seeing gravity now.
So my question to you is, but you're not seeing gravity, you're seeing the effects of gravity.
Correct, yes.
So exactly. So my point is that Allah Azza wa Jalla, you're not seeing him, but you're seeing the effect of what he's done. And I think this is important that it's understood well. I just think there's many ways I can tackle that point, but I just want to make it simple and easy for the people. I want them to understand is, don't give the aql an unrestricted. See, your eyesight, as I said before, it can see, but it needs light to see. If you switch off the light in your room, your eyesight, even though we can see, it can't see in the dark.
You see, the issue I have with this is that
the aql, even though it works, it functions, it's good, it brings about a lot of amazing things into this world, you know. But if there's no revelation to shine the path for it, the aql, it'll go all over the place. When Einstein developed the general relativity, the relativity theory. Before him was Isaac Newton, who had already pushed his theories, was put under scrutiny. It was undisputed. Many scientists, they trialed it, they tested it, and there was no need for anyone to come after and to try to correct or modify or, but Einstein did. And so this is the power of human mind. I was reading, subhanAllah, the Enigma code. You know the Enigma code? Where the World War II, the German were using the Enigma code. There was a man by the name of Alan Turing. What he did was that he looked into the Enigma code. He read it through mathematical theories, mathematical equations, and was able to break the Enigma code and basically stop World War II, or bring it to a halt, save millions of people. And again, I may not agree with these people's aqidah and their belief and whatnot, but it does show you the power of human reasoning, the power of aql, and the power of thinking. And there's no dispute and argument regarding that, you know. But the point here is that when somebody just puts the aql into a place that it doesn't deserve, it's, you know, the aql is like a leader. Okay, it's like a leader. It governs a particular land. It can't govern the whole entire world. It governs a particular land. And as time goes on, the leader, he loses his position. So there are times when the logic and the mind and the human thinking, there's moments where the naql will say to it, wait.
Naql being?
The text. And the revelation will say to it, look, this is not your, it's not your field. This is not, you're not entitled to speak about it over here.
Don't you think your approach is actually leading to a community of backwards people? So I think Islam and the Muslims is one of the only communities that I've seen where the aql, the intellect, is actually looked down upon. Mm-hmm. Where someone comes up with an opinion and you say, don't worry about him, he's just using his intellect. Mm-hmm. In every other community in the world, they actually push forward critical thinking, logic, reasoning. These are seen as good things. And in our community, we seem to suppress it and say, no, don't use your intellect. The scientific people are laughing at us, so it's making us look backwards.
Okay, this issue I really want people to understand is that the issue of revelation and reason having to be reconciled between the two is actually not true.
What do you mean?
You see, Ahlus Sunnah believe لا تعارض بين العقل الصريح والنقل الصحيح. There is no conflict, to be honest, between a sound mind, a sound reasoning, and an authentic revelation, an authentic text. There's no conflict between the two, to be honest. The conflict is something on your side. They're not contradicting one another. You think they are, but there isn't.
Okay, let's use that. Let's take an example. Shaytan urinates in the ear of the person who misses Salat al-Fajr. Is that an authentic text?
Oh, no, without a doubt.
Okay, I wake up in the morning, I can't feel the urine, I can't smell the urine. My intellect is clearly contradicting what the sound text is saying.
You see, again, you're saying that what is considered to be proof and what is considered to be an evidence is that which can be seen, smelt. Is that all you say?
That's my intellect. You're saying the intellect is limited.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm actually saying that intellect is actually, you believe in things you can't see. You believe in things that you can't hear. You believe in things that you can't smell. You believe in things that you can't, that are not empirical.
Give me an example of something I believe in like that.
You believe in the cosmos.
Hmm.
You believe in the starting of this universe and how it started. You believe in many things, that gravitational force, I just said to you. There are many things that you believe in which you can't observe.
Okay, but all of these things, I can observe the effect of it. I can't observe the effect of urine.
Oh, yes, now you can. I'll tell you the effect.
How?
Sleeping paralysis is something that is exactly what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. He told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that sleeping paralysis is shaitan, for example, telling the person, go to sleep. This is the important concept I want to understand. I want us to understand. There's many other things I want to talk about. I just don't want to go into it now because due to it not being the correct podcast for it. But there is a concept which they pushed, what they call it, the God of the gaps.
Mm.
Whenever you can't explain something, you just squeeze in God in there and that's your answer for everything. And then as time goes on, science will disprove it and the God would pop out of that gap and the gap gets more tighter and tighter as time goes on. And that's what they say. And I don't want to go into that now. I really want to discuss that when we, if we ever have a podcast on atheism and their common arguments. But let me go back to what I was saying, is that there is no conflict really between sound reasoning and an authentic text. There isn't. But idhalika, the scholars, they say, any individual who's closer to the revelation, you'll tend to find that they have the most soundest reasoning. I was reading Lawrence Krauss, he allows incest. I mean, he says that, you know, that's because he's far from revelation.
Mm.
So you see that he will, Richard Dawkins, he permitted, and he can see, he doesn't see any problem with mild paedophilia.
Mm. So the distance from revelation has actually caused them, their intellect to actually become more deficient. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, exactly. Let me give you an example of some Islamic thinkers, for instance. I was saying before, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, the book he wrote, he wrote a kitab called Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql. And this kitab is a refutation on Fakhruddin al-Razi. He's refuting Fakhruddin al-Razi. Fakhruddin al-Razi was one of the greatest Islamic thinkers.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he was a person who used Aql to its maxim. You know, he used it to its max. He stretched his brain. He was a great thinker, without a shadow of a doubt. There's something he came up with, which was known as al-Qanun al-Kulli. I want to explain it quickly. Qanun al-Kulli is that two premises and a conclusion. So he said qadiyah, ta'arud al-aqli wa al-naql, that the aql goes against the naql. The aql, which is the reasoning and thinking and rationality, versus text.
Mm.
You see, so he already, as you mentioned before, confirmation bias. He already alluded. He already he suppositions that there is a conflict between naql and aql.
Mm.
Okay, and then he said taqdim al aql an al naql, which is the second premise he brought, that you give precedence to the rationality over the text. And then last but not least, his evidence for that is that the aql is the foundation and the naql is the sub-branch. In other words, he said, the text, it benefits us, speculation. Like, it doesn't, it's speculative. It's actually not clear-cut. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah felt, okay, this doesn't make sense. So what Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah did was, he responded to him in 44 different angles, 44 different perspectives, 44 different wajh, in 10 volumes. And the beginning, he responds, first of all, he divides his answers into two, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. First one, he makes it into a jawab mujmal, a general answer. And that is four lines. Okay? That could be enough. Mm. But of course, they won't take it. So what he did was, then he went into 44 different angles of responding to Fakhruddin al-Razi, Shaykh al-Islam. 10 volumes. Okay? And these arguments that Fakhruddin al-Razi, to be honest, he wasn't the first to actually bring it. Al-Qadi Abdul Jabbar al-Hamadani al-Mu'tazili said it before him. Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni said it before him in Kitab al-Irshad. Also, even Abu Hamid al-Ghazali said it in his Kitab al-Qanun al-Ta'wil. ولذلك that Kitab Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql, if today that book had been translated in its totality, if it could be translated in the English language, it's an amazing book. Ibn al-Qayyim said, وَقْرَأْ كِتَابَ الْعَقْلِ وَالنَّقْلِ الَّذِي مَا فِي الْوُجُودِ لَهُ نَذِيرٌ ثَانِي. He said, read the book Al-Aql wal-Naql, for verily there is no book like it. You can actually say it's a masterpiece of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah's works. And that man, Fakhruddin al-Razi, imagine this. I was reading Tariq al-Islam by Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, that Fakhruddin al-Razi said, Amr ibn Salah, the author of the Kitab Muqaddimat fi Ulum al-Hadith, he mentioned that Fakhruddin al-Razi, in his later stages, his last moments of life, he said, "Laytani lam ashtaghil bil kalami wa baka." I wish I didn't busy myself with these philosophical arguments. I didn't busy myself with this rationality. There's a line of poetry that he said, "Laqad tuftu fi tilka al-ma'ahidi kulliha." He said, "I've traveled around all these academic researches. I've looked at all of them. Wa sayyartu tarafi bayna tilka al-ma'alimi falam ara illa, I have not seen illa wadi'an kaffa ha'irin ala dhaqnin aw qari'an sinna nadimi." I've only seen people who were confused and people who didn't know where things were going. I've looked at all of this. And it's true, Fakhruddin al-Razi did. And he said in another line of poetry, he said, لَقَدْ تَأَمَّلْتُ, I observed, I looked at الطُّرُقُ الْكَلَامِيَةِ وَالْمَنَاهِجِ الْفَلْسَفِيَةِ, I looked at these philosophical methodologies and discourses. فَمَا رَأَيْتُ وَتَشْفِي عَلِيلًا وَلَا تُرْوِي غَلِيلًا. And I saw that it doesn't answer any questions. There's another famous lines of poetry that's attributed to him, which is, نِهَايَةُ إِقْدَامِ الْعُقُولِ عِقَالُ وَغَايَةُ السَّعِي الْعَالَمِينَ ضَلَالُ وَأَرْوَاحِنَا فِي وَحْشَةٍ مِنْ جُسُومِنَا وَحَاصِلُ دُنْيَانَا أَذًى وَوَبَالُ وَلَمْ نَسْتَفِدْ مِنْ بَحْثِنَا طُولَ عُمْرِنَا سِوَى أَنْ جَمَعْنَا فِيهِ قِيلَ وَقَالُ. He said, the final ending of all of these philosophical arguments, the final conclusion and the end result has become that misguidance. Nothing substantial.
These are the words of a man who was one of the greatest Islamic thinkers and actually prioritized in his early life the aql over the text.
Well, that is some scholars like Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentioned that when you say al-imam, according to the Sha'ira, when they say the imam, they mean Fakhruddin al-Razi. That's it, it's him, no one else. I really want you to understand one thing. Scientists, they have to understand that science explains. Science argues and proves things, but it's not in any way, shape or form able to respond and answer everything. Science will never ever tell us why we're in this universe. What is our purpose in this dunya? Science will never, and it can't. That's not its field. It won't be able. Look at one scientist today. He has so many different beliefs, so many different theories that are contradicting one another. His own views are changing. I was reading the kitab Al-Ara' Fakhruddin al-Razi, written by a man called Muhammad al-Zarkani. He wrote a kitab on Fakhruddin al-Razi. I'm currently trying to summarize the book. He's talking about the Atharul Falsafiyah. Another sheikh, his name is called Abdullah ibn Ahmad al-Ansari. He wrote another kitab on the philosophical arguments of Fakhruddin al-Razi and how it affected his aqidah. These researches are written on him. Fakhruddin al-Razi, in one issue before, he had like three or four different views. To the extent Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, in his fifth volume, in Minhaj al-Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah, he said, it's sometimes hard to even say this is what Fakhruddin al-Razi believes. The reason is because fully dependent on the aql, it confuses you. You don't know what to say.
Okay. There is another issue that some people bring up, actually. The reason and the motive behind this, behind people like yourself pushing the fact that the text is superior to the intellect, is actually they want to control people. People will ask them questions. They don't want people to think on their own. They want to be able to tell people exactly what to do, how to practice their religion. And it's just a form of control. What do you have to say about that?
Now, if that would be a good argument if we were saying you have to follow humans and you have to follow myself, and that's a good argument. But if you're saying that you and I both are forced to follow that text, then as much as you have to, so do I. So I don't think it's me trying to control you or you trying to control me. We're both being, you know, it's both necessary on both of us, and it's required from both of us to follow the text.
There is a hole in your argument, however, and that is when you say that the text is superior to the intellect. Actually, the scholars of hadith, who are the ones with the permission of Allah who are actually preserving the text, they tend to disagree with you. For example, you have Imam Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah, who said things like, for a text to be authentic, a condition upon it is لم يخالف المعقول, that it can't go against the reason. So you're sitting here saying that the text, the authentic text, should be pushed above the intellect because the intellect has limitations. And he, who is actually the one who's authenticating the text, is actually saying, I only authenticate if it goes in line with my reason.
Again, what you have to understand is, number one, as I said to you before, the text doesn't go against the aqal. I already said to you, that doesn't happen. And if it does, it's subjective. It's what you think. And you just have to take it to what? You just have to take it to someone who knows it and somebody who can explain it to you. ولذلك Ibn al-Qayyim said, وَنُصُوصُهُ لَيْسَتْ تُعَارِضُ بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا فَسَلْ عَنْهَا عَلِيمَ زَمَانِ وَإِذَا ظَنَنْتَ تَعَارُضًا فِيهَا فَذَا مِنْ آفَةِ الْأَفْهَامِ وَالْأَذْهَانِ أَوْ أَنْ يَكُونَ الْبَعْضُ لَيْسَ بِثَابِتٍ مَا قَالَهُ الْمَبْعُوثُ بِالْقُرْآنِ. He said, وَنُصُوصُهُ لَيْسَتْ تُعَارِضُ بَعْضُهَا. Allah's texts, they don't oppose one another. So what do you do? فَسَلْ عَنْهَا عَلِيمَ زَمَانِي. Take it to a person of knowledge. I promise you, he will show you that it's a deficiency on your side. وَإِذَا ظَنَنْتَ تَعَارُضًا. He said, if there is a conflict between a text and your rationality, you're unable to fathom it. There's one of three situations. I remember this all the time. If you see a text supposedly going against the rationality or it's going against the thinking process, then it's one of three. عدم صحة النقل. This text is not even authentic in the first place. It's weak. Number two, عدم فهم النقل فهما صحيحا. You are unable to comprehend the text correctly. And number three, عدم صحة العقل. The عقل is actually deficient. You're an insane person. It's one of those three situations. So it's not possible that the aql and the naql go against one another. And the aql I'm talking about here is, I'm talking about the aql which is sarih, or it's healthy, it's sound. The person is not a lunatic, the person is not deranged, the person is not insane. And the text is authentic. لذلك, two things that are contradicting one another have to both be present, right? What about you can't have two things you think are contradicting one another when one doesn't even exist. Second is that try to understand it properly in the first place. And the last but not least, then question your rationality, to be honest.
And give me some advice. And if I'm a layman Muslim and I come across a text that to me, it on the apparent, it contradicts my intellect, where do I go from there? Let's start with that question. Where do I go from there?
Just like if you read a medical book, who do you take it to? Expertise. You take it to a specialized person. You ask him. You say, "What is this? What do the scientists mean in this regard? What does this term mean? What is meant by this?" So the same thing. When you read the revelation, take it to the expertise. There's the people who are specialized in this field.
And if the answer I'm given, it just still doesn't comfort my intellect, for example, what should I prioritize?
You see, Allah told us the from the beginning of Islam, from the beginning of revelation, Allah told us in the Quran that there's always been two camps. Okay, the first camp is those who follow the revelation and those who follow their desires. Mm. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says in the ayah, فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ فَعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاهُمْ. If they don't follow you, Muhammad, then know that they are following their desires. The way that the people follow their desires in different ways, okay, is in different ways. A group of people follow their desires by giving the aql an unrestricted strength, an unrestricted platform where the aql can do what it wishes and how it wishes. That's one form of people oppose it with their desires. Another group of people, the Sufiya, who oppose it based on their feelings and what they feel like. There are those who oppose the aql based on customs and cultures. Ahlul Taghrib. You see, they'll say to you, our values is not this, and our this, you know. The third people is the statements of the imams of their madhab.
Mm.
And they'll say to you, our madhab doesn't believe this, and our imam never said this. So desires and revelations always been a conflict. Lakin not aql.
You've mentioned before on this podcast previously that we should follow the religion the way the companions followed it. Now there was a hadith again where the companions were sent away on a battalion, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam set one of them as the leader, as the emir, and he commanded the other group, the rest of the group, to jump into a fire. Now, if they were to follow the text like you're suggesting, they would have jumped into the fire, because the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam put this guy in charge, and he also said you should follow the emir.
Mm-hmm.
But they didn't. Mm-hmm. They said, no, this doesn't make sense to us. They didn't ask someone. Notice how they didn't ask the messenger.
Mm-hmm.
They actually just said, this doesn't make sense to us, so we're not going to jump in the fire. Afterwards, they then went and asked the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he said, you did the right thing by not jumping in the fire. Doesn't this show that actually there are occasions where when you are approached with a text and it doesn't make sense to you, that it is okay to follow what you believe? That's what they did, right?
Okay, what you have to understand is messengers and prophets were sent with that which is textual and that which is reasonable. Prophets didn't come with things that are not reasonable, things that can't rationally be fathomed, that can't be understood. As I said to you before, Ibn al-Qayyim said in his kitab Sawa'iq al-Mursala, he said, فَالْكِتَابُ الْمُنْزَلُ وَالْعَقْلُ الْمُدْرِكُ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى خَلْقِهِ. The proof of Allah against the creation is two things. The first one is كِتَابُ الْمُنْزَلُ, the revelation. وَالْعَقْلُ الْمُدْرِكُ, rationality, reason. Reason and revelation, both of them are the proof of Allah against the creation.
Mm.
So what these sahabas did was, they took the reason and the revelation and they reconciled it. They brought it together. There was no conflict, to be honest. They just saw that this is how it's done. What they did was, they obeyed the leader, as the Prophet told them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in that which is good.
Mm.
See, the concept of obedience, it's not unrestricted. You know what I mean? It's the Prophet ﷺ didn't say unrestrictedly obey him. The Prophet said obey him. So the aql will tell you that the obedience, where it is and what it's not. And the Prophet, all he did was, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he reinforced that. He said, innama al-aql innama al-ta'atu bil ma'roof, that the obedience is in that which is ma'roof. But they didn't say our aql tells us not to obey the leader at all in any way, shape, or form. Then you would say to me, they did go against what the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said.
So even the fact that they didn't jump in the fire, that actually revelation has told you not to commit suicide, not to bring harm upon yourself. So they were actually following the revelation anyway by not doing that. Okay. Are there any statements from the companions that talk about the limitation of the aql and how the text itself should be followed over the aql?
I told you the statement of the, well, I didn't say it was a statement, but Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he said that the aql is like the eyesight. Just like the eyesight is limited in seeing, he said that the aql is also limited in how far it can see. And so both of them are governed by the text. Well, in that, Ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. He said, "الشرع ولى العقل ثم عزله." That the Sharia, it gave governorship and leadership to the aql, and then it can take it down if it once wishes to. You see, also Al-Imam Ash-Shatibi said, إِذَا تَعَاضَضَ النَّقْلُ وَالْعَقْلُ عَلَى الْمَسَائِلِ الشَّرْعِيَةِ فَعَلَى شَرْطِ أَنْ يَتَقَدَّمَ النَّقْلُ فَيَكُونُ مَتْبُوعًا وَيَتَأَخَّرُ الْعَقْلُ فَيَكُونُ تَابِعًا فَلَا يَسْرَحُ الْعَقْلُ فِي مَجَالِ النَّظَرِ إِلَّا بِقَدْرِ مَا يُسَرِّحُهُ الْعَقْلُ. In simple terms, Shatibi said, Al-Aqlu tabi'un wa al-Naqlu matbu'un. that the aql follows and the text is the leader.
Okay, that was a really fascinating discussion. Jazakallahu khairan for the points that you made today. Until next time, subhanaka wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
I hope you enjoyed and benefited from that discussion. Please do share it with your friends and family members if you feel like they might benefit too. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button below so you're notified of any new episodes. Check out www.thehotseatpodcast.com. That's thehotseatpodcast.com. On there, you'll find a little bit more information about the podcast, and you'll also have the chance to vote for which topic you'd like to see discussed on the show. You can also ask questions on the website to the speaker himself about these contemporary, modern day issues. Until next time, fi amalillahi, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.